Well, when we're ready, we'll be ready. It'll be great. Hey, and testing 1, 2, check 1, 2. Here we are. Am I not? Not yet. Not yet. And I'm going to make more noises. Hello! Welcome to Calgary East Church of the Nazarene. It is good to be with you today. I don't know, when I stepped outside today, it was just like, wow, it feels sort of like spring, which is a nice deep breath to take in before the cold front that is coming. But, you know, we'll just take that deep breath and we'll plow through here. If you're visiting with us, I'll just introduce myself. My name is Ryan Herbert. I get to pastor here. And if you're joining us online or in person, we're gathered here to worship Jesus Christ today. And so I want to welcome you in his name and say it is good to be with you. I have a couple of announcements for you today. One of those is that next week we'll have our end of the month soup lunch. And if you want to sign up, I'm going to stick this at the back there. Please feel free to sign up. And as a tag on to our Super Sunday, I've heard that people want to throw my wife and I a baby shower. And so as much as I feel awkward inviting you to do that, please come and celebrate with us. We are delighted that we have this little one on the way, and delighted already at some of the gifts that you've given us already. I'll say if you don't really know us, it's okay if you don't bring a gift and you want to come to the soup lunch. We're not going to be like, please come, more the merrier, by all means. So we celebrate at the Lord's table. But that is happening. That's next weekend, so the baby shower and the soup lunch. If you can bring buns or soup, please feel free to write it down there. The other thing is, last week, I think it was last week, that I mentioned a memorizing challenge where I've split up a chapter of Scripture into different pieces. And what I've actually done, thank you so much for those of you who helped me fold these, I've made it into a game. If you would like to draw a unequal fifth of Matthew chapter 6 and memorize it, and you're just like, I don't know what to choose, I don't know. I've split up chapter 6 into 5 pieces, and there's a bunch of those pieces right here. You could draw one out. You might get a short piece, you might get a long piece. None of them are, in my mind, impossibly long. You know, it might take you a little, it'll be effort, but not effort wasted. So if you want to play that game, come find me. I'll hold the box for you and everything, and we can do it that way. And if you want to recite after that, to say like, oh, I wouldn't mind reciting this when we get to Matthew 6. We're still a few weeks away from that. I think it'll be, I can't remember if it's post-Easter even, but when it comes time, if you want to recite it publicly, I would love for you to share that with us. And if not, just memorize it yourself. And before I natter away at you anymore, I'd like to invite Danella up for our mission moment today. Welcome, Danella.
It usually begins with a dream, a God-sized dream. Pastor Johnny in Costa Rica had such a dream. He and the church leadership felt led by the Lord to purchase a specific property just outside of their community of San Pedro de Poas in Costa Rica. They prayed and they prayed for months, and finally they received the news they had only hoped for, an alabaster offering to be used to help with the down payment of their land. For many years, they worshiped there in the open air under some trees. Then they added a metal roof to shelter some folks from the sun. It took many years to pay off the property, but at last it was done. Through many stages of growth and construction, the Poas Church has become a beacon in the community. They're known for their compassion and love for their community. Their newest ministry is a childcare facility for those who most need it. From Pastor Johnny's dream of owning property up until today, God has blessed the Poas Church of the Nazarene as they continue to serve him faithfully. And it all started with an alabaster offering. In Mexico, the Olmeca district is the only one of the 15 districts that does not have a home or office for the district superintendent. This is a financial drain on the district since they pay rent for an apartment. Thankfully, they have property and they began the construction, but with economic downturns, the funds were not there to continue. The dream seemed to be impossible. In late 2020, after much prayer and seeking of the Lord, God blessed the Olmeca District with an alabaster offering to help them get started once again on the building project. Now in 2021, the house has a roof and more work is being done each week. In addition to alabaster, the district has been supported by 5 churches in the USA who are each providing an offering for various amounts to complete this project. 2021 is looking bright for the Olmeca District thanks to alabaster and offerings from folks like you. These are just 2 of numerous stories of how the Alabaster Fund has helped and is currently helping with the purchase of property and the construction of buildings on the mission field. Everyone's little bit makes a huge difference. Did you know that churches around the world give to Alabaster too? With everyone working together all across the globe, more people can have the opportunity to learn about Jesus and become His disciple. Thank you for your offering to Alabaster.
Good morning. I just thought that was really interesting. Sometimes we don't realize where the alabaster money goes. We can say, but it's pictures. I'm a picture person, so I was quite excited when I found that. This morning, I want, if you've brought your alabaster boxes, or if you want to give, you haven't got an alabaster box, we can also do it by e-transfer or just by putting money in. I'm going to take the roof off our little church, and if you want to come now and share your offerings.
And He established them forever and ever. He issued a decree that will never pass away. Praise the Lord from the earth, you great sea creatures, and all ocean depths. Lightning and hail, snow and clouds, stormy winds that do His bidding. You mountains and all hills, fruit trees and all cedars, wild animals and all cattle, small creatures and flying birds. Kings of the earth and all nations, you princes and all rulers on earth, young men and women, old men and children, let them praise the name of the Lord, for His name alone is exalted. His splendor is above the earth and the heavens. And He has raised up for His people a horn, the praise of all His faithful servants of Israel, the people close to His heart. Praise the Lord. This is the word of God.
We're going to join together this morning in a multitude angels singing. And you know, all across the world today, there are churches, they're giving praise to God. And that is just so amazing. Just picture that in your mind, the power of prayer across this world and what it can do if we reach out and we can talk with God and give him that praise. Let's stand together. We're going to sing a song called Hosanna, and you got it. Praise is rising.
Hosanna, Hosanna, come of your way throne, I gladly bow my knee and worship you alone. All empty claims the glory of the risen Lord. Who can compare with the beauty of the Lord? Forever you will be the Lamb upon the throne. I gladly bow my knee and worship you.
Altar is ready for everyone. If you want, please feel free to join. Let's pray. My Jesus, my Lord, my King of glory, wonderful Counselor, mighty God, and Prince of Peace and Everlasting Father. Father, you are the Alpha and Omega, the beginning and the end. You are the Christ, the Son of living God. You are King of kings, Lord of lords. Among the Lord, there is none like you. With my whole heart, we praise you, God. Thank you, God. You gave your only Son who shed his blood on the cross to us for giving us salvation. Now he set us free from sin and we receive salvation because salvation belongeth unto the Lord. Lord, I lift up our every member in your hand. Thank you, Lord, you bring them safe in your sanctuary for worshiping you. Thank you, Lord, for giving them great heart, for believing you as our Lord, as our Savior. Lord, I pray for everyone who are suffering various illness like me. Dear Jesus, you are the divine physician. You are the healer of the sick. We come to you in this time of need. We place our worries, anxieties, concern, and struggle on you, who carries our burden for us. We place this illness under your care and humbly ask that you restore us and give us the strength to endure. We are praying for missionary, evangelist, church planter, pastor, general superintendent, district superintendent. Lord, they are serving you and they are presenting you to the believers and non-believers people. All the nation you have made will come and worship before you, Lord. Lord, we pray for them. They're extending your name from one nation to another. Because of your name, many missionaries, evangelists, church planter, and pastor are persecuted, even their family too. Lord, protect them and keep them safe. Lord, we pray for your angels will surrounding to them and their families as hedge of protection. Father, we pray for our pastor as he opens your word to preach. Lord, we pray that the message he has planned will meet the need of the hour. Father, help him to preach what he has prepared in a way that will glorify you and that will encourage those who are listening. Help us to remember that we serve a God who is big, who is strong, and who is mighty. May all of us lean faithfully and rest securely in your mighty arm, in the powerful name of Jesus. Amen.
Well, if you could stand with us again as we continue on in song and praise.
crimson stain. He washed it by the snow. Lord, now indeed I find thy power and thine alone can change the leper's spot. Made it all to him I owe. Sin had left a crimson stain. He washed it white as snow. For nothing good have I, whereby thy grace to claim. Died my soul to save, my lips just to repeat. Jesus paid it all to him I owe. Sin had left a crimson stain, he washed it white as snow.
Morning, church. Our scripture reading today is from Matthew chapter 5, verses 21 through 26. Hear the word of the Lord from Matthew 5, 21 to 26. You have heard it was said to a people long ago, "You shall not murder, and anyone who murders will be subject to judgment. But I tell you that anyone who is angry with a brother or sister will be subject to judgment. Again, anyone who says to a brother or sister, 'Raca,' is answerable to a court. And anyone who says, 'You fool,' will be in danger of the fires of hell. Therefore, if you are offering your gift at the altar, and there remember that your brother or sister has something against you, leave your gift there in front of the altar. First go and be reconciled with them. Then come and offer your gift. Settle matters quickly with your adversary who is taking you to court. Do it while you are still together on the way, or your adversary may hand you over to the judge, and the judge may hand you over to the officer, and you may be thrown into prison. Truly, I tell you, you will not get out until you have paid the last penny." This is the word of the Lord.
The Mount, pretty in Jesus' famous, maybe most famous sermon. He started by blessing the needy, the helpful, the persecuted. Last week we looked at the part where he calls his disciples the salt and light of the world. He affirmed the ongoing authority of the Hebrew Scriptures, what we call the Old Testament. And then he made this bold declaration that kind of then sucks us into the rest of his teaching. He said, "Unless your righteousness exceeds that of the scribes and Pharisees, you will never enter the kingdom of heaven." And I want you to hold on to that as an anchoring point as we consider this next piece, because he then starts to give examples about the righteousness that exceeds that of the scribes and Pharisees. He tells us about the righteousness of God's kingdom, and that's what we're looking at today. As we listen to Matthew's reading, some of you might have thought to yourselves, well, Jesus is pretty direct, probably a little more direct than most Canadian politeness would allow us to be. And that's like a couple weeks in a row. He calls out the scribes and Pharisees, and then he's got hellfire on the mind. You're sort of like, I'm sorry, what? It's the first time that Jesus mentions hellfire in Matthew's gospel, but it's not the last. In each of the major teaching sections in Matthew's gospel, the warning of judgment rings out really clearly. And I'm highlighting that because I think that's surprising to some readers, perhaps to many of us. It's sort of surprising to me because we have this idea that if you're going to look for wrath and fire in the Bible, you go to your Old Testament, right? You go to the Old Testament, you read about, this angry God who just needs his people to live up to what's actual righteousness and all of this. And then Jesus comes and it's all nice and forgiveness and sort of that angry God image fades, right? You're like, so then you hear these words on Jesus' lips and you're like, what's happening? Wait a second, that's not how this is supposed to go. But that idea is actually a misconception to both. It's a misconception that God is all anger and wrath in the Old Testament. It's a misconception that Jesus is all niceness and mercy and you do you in the New Testament. And you can only reach those conclusions by not reading your Bible very carefully. Essentially, the Old Testament is full of the mercy of Yahweh to his people, of the patience, the long-suffering love, the generosity, the forgiveness, and certainly consequences and righteous judgment. And then Jesus comes and he's consistent with that picture all the way through, right? And now I highlight that for us because, at least for me, when I read passages like this one, the misconception behind that, where you've sort of divorced, in a sense, the Old Testament picture of Yahweh from the idea that I have about Jesus being all nice and splendid, then makes it sort of confusing to hear Jesus bring words of judgment. And you're like, I'm not sure if I know this Jesus. Are we sure this was Jesus? Like, is that this guy? And yes, we are sure. What I want you to do is hold on to that sense of, like, what? That surprise, and let it draw you to listen more carefully instead of draw you to say, you know what, I'm just kind of offended and scared, and I'm just going to, well, just back away slowly. Let's listen carefully to what Jesus has to say today. It's a hard passage to listen to in some ways, but it's a good one. If I could take one point today and plant that in our hearts, it would be something like this. It would be that Jesus promises his disciples a life that is set free from contempt, set free from resentment, and set free from the mastery of anger. I'm just going to hit that again. There's one point that I want to hit for us today. Jesus promises his disciples a life that is set free from contempt, free from resentment, and free from the mastery of anger. Now, the idea of this being a promise takes some careful reading to see, because as we've already mentioned, the tone is a little scary, honestly. There's this threatening phrase, anyone who says, you fool, will be in danger of the fires of hell, and you're like, okay, that sounds very promising, doesn't it? That sounds like the kind of promise in the movies where the enemy is actually like just sort of subtly threatening you, or you're like, and you ask, I'm sorry, was that a threat? And they're like, no. That's a promise. And you're like, thanks, Clint Eastwood. That's great. But that's not the kind of promise that I mean, right? I'm not saying that he's promising this threat. It's actual promise of freedom from these things that can master us. So just hold on with me. These five verses are part of this bigger sermon. So what is he talking about? The righteousness that surpasses that of the scribes and Pharisees. The righteousness that is characteristic of the kingdom of heaven that is coming even in him. Jesus told us he's fully behind the Old Testament and God's commands to Israel. He's also told us that he's going to fulfill those commands. And I appreciate that Matthew sort of organizes his sermon in this way, that Jesus gives us that up front, because he sort of looks like he's getting rid of the Old Testament command a little bit to say, yeah, that doesn't have authority. But no, he actually kind of levels it up at each of these times where he says, you've heard that it was said. This is the first. You've heard that it was said, but I say to you. He's got several more that are coming here. These commands that he's giving us are aimed past just living up to the letter of the law into what those laws were intended, which is to cultivate life with God, cultivate this relationship with God. Is preparing us for the kingdom of heaven. So I'm going to hit this point several times just because I want it to be like etched in our memories. Part of life in the kingdom is freedom from contempt and resentment and the mastery of anger. And let's look into each of those. If you want to pick up with me at verse 21 here, we'll wait for the soundtrack to finish. And you have heard that it was said to the people long ago, you shall not murder, and anyone who murders will be subject to judgment. But I tell you that anyone who is angry with a brother or sister will be subject to judgment. Again, anyone who says to a brother or sister, Raca, is answerable to the court. And anyone who says, you fool, will be in danger of the fire of hell. And if we trace Jesus' line of thinking towards sort of like one unified topic, you can see he's concerned about anger. What do you do with your anger? He starts with the Old Testament command. And does anyone know? He says, if you kill someone, you're liable to judgment. What was the judgment that the law of Moses prescribed for murder? Depends which kind. So an intentional premeditated killing is the definition of murder that we'll work with this morning. Death. Yeah, it's a capital punishment. And so you have the Old Testament command that defends the dignity of human life to the degree that if you were to shatter that dignity, you can no longer continue to live. It says the value of human life is too precious to make up for with a fine or with a material gift. It's no, there's no way to redeem this. So it puts basically the value of human life very, very precious. Killing in war is not treated the same way, which is a great point from Harry here. Killing in self-defense is not treated the same way, but intentional, premeditated killing is among the most serious of the crimes in God's law. So the Old Testament says no to murder. And Jesus goes a little bit further than that. He says no to the anger that leads to murder as well. This is a spot where careful reading or careful translation are needed one way or the other. You read through the NIV, and you might hear Jesus say something like, if you feel angry, you're in danger of judgment. And I don't think that's what the Greek rendering is going to get at. So if I can nerd out with you a little bit, I'm not trying to play loose with the text to sort of make this less demanding on us. I think it's still plenty demanding. But you could read the NIV and hear that. Say, you know what, if you feel angry, you're in danger of judgment. You better get ready for hellfire. It's like, no, that's not what Jesus is getting at here. The Greek word here is grammar nerd, it's a participle form, which means it's the ongoing action. If I say that's a runner, that's the noun, runner. If I say that person is running, that's the continual form, right? They're in the process of running. If I say you run, I could be saying a command or just a description, that verb, run. So it's the participle, the ongoing form. And so you might say anyone who is angrying with a brother or sister doesn't come across very nicely. You know, but anyone who is raging maybe against a brother or sister, anyone who is holding on to anger against a brother or sister is in danger of judgment. That's what Jesus is getting at with his first point here. To say, it's not just murder that kind of gives us the limits for anger. It's if you hold on to this anger against your brother or sister, you're in danger of judgment. That's part one of this three-part declaration. He goes into part two, which I'm calling contempt today. Basically, when someone's treated you poorly, in that moment, you feel that swell, right, of anger. It's kind of a rush of energy. You feel a little bit hot in the face, maybe. Everything gets a little bit tense. We're going to call that one anger, and you can decide what to do with that feeling or not. If you hold on to that, I'm going to call that one our first point. If you hold on to anger. But, you know, then there's the next day. And if you held on to that anger in the moment, but then you kind of just like stuck it in the fridge overnight, and it gets a little soggy around the edges. You didn't cover it up. It doesn't stay crisp. I'm going to call that contempt. Because the next day, you run into your coworker again, right? And you're not ready to blow up at them like you were when that first hit of energy came when they really ticked you off, right? It's not the same feeling. But also, you're not ready to let go of that anger. It's just kind of cold and soggy in the fridge. And so you might let them know that, no, we're not cool. We're still not okay. You say that with a choice insult here or there, or just maybe a cool distance, a chilly silence, and you let them know, yeah. And then that's kind of what Raka is getting at. You basically, you're so offended by this person and the stupid thing that they did, that you're just going to treat them like they don't matter anymore. Contempt would be a position of anger that's going cold and soggy in your fridge overnight, and you're like, I'm not going to treat you like you matter to me anymore. It's just that distance, right? We're going to call that point two, Raka. You fool. You don't matter. You're unimportant. We'll call that contempt. So we got hot anger. It's a rush of energy. We've got cold, soggy fridge anger. It's gotten cold overnight. And you can hold on to that for a long time. It can mold in your fridge. It's just bad. But hold on to that image, right? Because like you know anger spoils, right? You hold on to it. It doesn't get better with age, right? It holds on. So if you're laughing at that image, great, awesome. I'm hoping that this is funny. But like also, I'm hoping that's a good image for holding, like, oh yeah, contempt is sort of like that. It starts to get soggy. It's not very enjoyable like it used to be, that hot rush of anger. And it just gets worse and worse the longer you leave it in your fridge, right? Basically, if they want to be an idiot, we'll just treat them that way. It's cold. And so Jesus says no to contempt, just like he says no to the hot rush of anger. And then he gets at this other piece. His final no on the topic of anger is another side of holding on. You don't have to put that anger in the fridge for it to get cold and soggy. You could put that anger on the burner and just let it simmer. You know? Just let it be ready, that just in case that person comes over, it's going to give them a little slosh of it here, right? You just let it, stay at that boiling point. It's not boiling over like it was at first, but you let it simmer there, and you let them have it. And what Jesus says here is, you have to get kind of nerdy in the Greek, but the Greek word more is not only a term of contempt where it's like, you don't matter to me anymore because you're stupid. It's you're stupid and you're bad. I don't think you're just a dumb person who broke this thing and now I'm upset at you and I just can't trust you anymore. It's like, no, you actually meant to do that. It's blame against that person. You think not just a dumb person, that's a bad person. And so that mora has a moral overtone where it's like a person's not just dumb, they're bad. Stupid, self-centered jerk, you know? And it's you let him know. And he's like, if you held on to that resentment, you're in danger of this judgment of God. And it's another way that we hold on to our anger. You just let it simmer on the back burner there until you can slosh it around a little bit and let him have it again. And Jesus says no to all three of these angers, all three of these forms. And I don't know, you can read a little bit of escalation into each of these, but I think the main point that he has, whether it's judgment, danger before the council, danger of the hell of fire. You can see sort of an escalation, but I think he's just encapsulating all of these things. So you hold on to anger, you're not cool before God, you're not hitting the righteousness that is characteristic of the kingdom of heaven. And I want you to, as Jesus calling his disciples, salt and light. You can enter into this kingdom of heaven. Jesus teaches the disciple that part of life in this kingdom is freedom from contempt, freedom from resentment, freedom from the mastery of anger. Just to sit in this point a little bit longer, you might hear me saying freedom from anger's mastery, right? And I'm not saying freedom from anger because I think that would be misleading. Jesus himself experienced anger. And anger is an involuntary physiological response to people when they threaten you, when they scare you, when they do you wrong. You're going to feel anger. And if you read this passage and you think, oh no, I feel anger every so often, and therefore I'm really in trouble with Jesus. That's not what he's getting at. What he is doing is he's taking the responsibility of what you do with that anger. He lands that square in your lap, and he says, that is your choice. Whether you're going to let anger do its job, which psychologically, I'm sure someone here is probably even more versed in this than I am, but anger basically is an alert that tells you something's wrong here. That's not okay. We need to do something about that. And Jesus is saying, well, you can hold on to that anger and let it be your master, let it decide what you're going to do next, or you can let it do its job of alerting you something's wrong here and respond from a point of love of neighbor, self-control, all kinds of things that he's about to teach you, about to say, okay, you don't have to let anger make the choice for how you respond to this. And so that's why I keep on saying anger's mastery, not just anger. Jesus himself experiences anger, and he shows us godly response to things when they're just wrong. So it's okay to feel like something is wrong, but don't let that feeling of anger boil over and decide the course of action. It leads to things like murder, where the Old Testament is like, okay, I'm going to put a lid on that and say, okay, whatever you do when you get angry, don't kill somebody, okay? Because that would be devastating to the creation that God has built here, and it's not going anywhere good. So it puts a limit on anger that way. Jesus says, no, no, no. When anger swells up, you take note of it, and you respond not with anger, but with this righteousness of the kingdom of heaven. So he gives us a couple of examples then, later on, about how to do that. Before I jump in there, are we good? This is pretty clear. I'm getting lots of thumbs up, lots of nods today. You guys are good. You're tracking with me. This is great. So he gives us a couple of scenes for managing conflict then. And they feel a little backwards because he flips it around to say, it's not when you're angry, it's when someone's mad at you. Here's what you do about it. And if you want to know, well, what would I do if I'm mad at somebody? You have to keep reading until like chapter 18. And he gets at the conflict from the other side. So I'm just going to leave that as a teaser. And if you're like, no, I can't handle that, then go read Matthew 18. I'll just leave that for you. It won't take you long. It might take you long to get over what Jesus tells you in Matthew 18, but it won't take you long to read it and find out what Jesus tells you. So we'll keep going here. He says, therefore, meaning because anger itself is under the judgment of God, not just murder, holding on to anger, holding on to resentment and contentment is under the judgment of God. If you are offering your gift at the altar, and there remember that your brother or sister has something against you, leave your gift there in front of the altar. First go and be reconciled to them. Then come and offer your gift. So scene one for managing conflict. It's a little confusing for us because we don't do animal sacrifices anymore. So let me set the scene if I can, just as well as I can with descriptions. You've been standing in line at the temple because there's only one temple where you can offer legitimate sacrifice. You're standing in line with everybody else who happens to bring their animal for sacrifice today, and you've come to the altar. Finally, it is your turn in line, and I don't know when was the last time you stood in line for a passport or registry, but it's, you know, think something official, but then mix that with, here we are before God, and this is a moment of prayer, this is a moment of closeness where I can address God, whether it's this offering of thanksgiving or an offering of atonement for my sin. It's like this close, close moment with God. Finally, you're there before whatever team of priests is on duty at the altar there today, and they're ready to go, and you remember, oh, man, I should not have said that to Harry yesterday. God. Maybe you could imagine coming for communion at the end of the month. And you come up and you're like, you're ready to receive the elements, the body and blood of Jesus. And you just look at your pastor in the face and suddenly you realize, oh, shoot, I should not have said that. And you just sort of have to hold up your hand and walk away and say, I'll be right back. I need to make a phone call or I need to go see somebody, right? It's like that kind of interruption that doesn't make any sense in the flow of the moment. It's like, no. Surely the thing to do is to like finish your service and then we'll deal with that, right? Surely the thing to do is like, hey, we'll finish with the priests because there's still the lineup. I don't want to go all the way to the back of the line again. And Jesus says, no, leave your gift there at the altar. Go and make it right with your brother first. Make it right with your sister before you come and offer this gift. And if it feels backwards to you, I can't feel like it should. It felt backwards to Jesus' listeners for the same reasons that you're feeling. I was like, that's just a huge interruption. And surely I should make sure I'm right with God before I like deal with this little thing between me and my brother. And Jesus says, no, hold on. It's not like that. Yeah, you should make things right with God. And to do that, you've got to be right. You've got to take care of things with your neighbor. This offering means nothing if things are not right between you and your brother, you and your neighbor. In order to put God first, care for your neighbor before your sacrifices would be a paraphrase here. And to get practical with that, we're hearing the word of God today. This is a word to us. I think it's an important practice, and we could make it a practice here at Calgary East that every time we come to the communion table, you sort of make that examination of your conscience to say, hey, before I come and receive these elements, Is there anybody who I need to call up and say, are we okay? Or, I know we're not okay. That's usually what it looks like for me in a reconciling conversation. Sometimes you're not sure what's wrong, and you have to get on the phone, and it's like, hi, I've got a feeling like something's not right between us. Can you help me have an idea how we could make things right? And if they're like, I don't know what you're talking about, you're probably cool, right? There's no issue between you, right? But maybe it's more specific than that, and you know the wrong that you've done. It's like, hey, I know I did wrong to you. How can I make that right? And Jesus is saying, you want to get close to God? You don't just come to the altar with all that baggage that's in the way. You get rid of the baggage, and that's getting close to God. That's a more valuable sacrifice than any kind of participation, any kind of beautiful worship service you can do. You might want to get a head start on that if you're like me, where it's like, well, actually, it's been a while since I heard Jesus take all of this so seriously about loving neighbor. I need to come to shorter accounts with people. And before you're coming to the communion table next week, maybe you take some time this week to do an audit of your relationships and say, am I cool with people before we gather around the table next week? Now, I'm sure Jesus could say to us today, you know what, it doesn't have to be once a month. This needs to be more regular because we step on each other's toes all the time and you want to keep those short accounts. But I wonder if the communion table can be just as visceral at least once a month, if not every Sunday as you're coming to worship and say, you know what, before I open my mouth to praise the Lord, am I all right with my neighbors? Have I made things right? Have I done what is on me to come to peace with them? The scriptures are honest about saying, you know, sometimes a grudge is a two-way street. And so if you have a problem with somebody, you can only do so much to make things right. Sometimes forgiveness just isn't on offer. But he's just saying, for how much it depends on you, live at peace with people. Live at peace with the people around you. Now, I've just given you maybe lots or maybe just a few deep holes to go down. I've only got a little bit left to talk with you about, but I just want to... If the Lord is speaking to you about specific relationships right now, I'd like to invite you to just sort of take note of those, especially if you need to write them down, do that. That's more important, obviously, than listening to the rest of the sermon because of what Jesus just told us, right? So, but if Jesus is speaking to you about specific relationships, take note of those. Pray for his help to address those because it takes courage to say, hey, I think I've done wrong. Can I make this right with you? But I will just finish out our passage here, even if you're half here and half there. The last two verses teach us not to let conflict sit and wait. I'm not going to read through the passage again, but I think it works a little something like that. Don't pretend that the longer you let it sit, the better it's going to get. The phrase, time heals all wounds, it doesn't work with physical wounds. And I don't know why we would expect it to work with relational ones. Jesus certainly doesn't, because you know time turns wounds into like infections and useless limbs, turns them into disease, deep scars. And so Jesus says, you know what? If someone's got something against you, like don't waste a minute. Don't waste a minute. Go and settle it with them. And the word in the Greek there is like, go and befriend them. Make it as close as possible while like before this gets to court, before this gets out of hand where someone's actually taking you to court and they're suing you over the offense, make things right as friends. Maybe you're not friends with them. And he says, just get as close as you can to that, as quickly as you can. Don't let it sit. And with the logic of their penalties, it basically goes something like this. We're just going to say that Ryan owes Susan $10,000. Okay? I don't know if I backed into her car really violently or something, but like, we'll just say Ryan owes Susan $10,000. And the way that it works in the legal system in Jerusalem these days, not these days, Jesus' days, is if I can't pay, and I'm taken to court, and it's clearly seen from a legal perspective with witnesses and all, like, I have to pay. What happens is I get thrown into prison, and I'm in prison until I can pay back the debt. And usually that would happen by, well, I better liquefy some assets here. So I'm going to sell either myself into, like, as many years as it takes for me to work up to that $10,000, or I'm going to sell the people that I own or the things that I own, or my family or friends have to somehow bail me out. Gotta liquidate my assets so I can make this, and I can't go free until I have paid, as Jesus says, the last penny, right? the last tiny coin. You don't get out till your debt is paid. As the logic goes like this, you know, before you get to court and wind up in prison because of the wrong that you did, go and settle it, because it's going to be so much easier to pay back that debt if you can still work. And so Ryan goes to Susan and says, hey, so I've got this plan. These are my living expenses. This is how much income I can make. These are the extra overtime hours I can pick up. And I think I can pay you back by this time. Does that sound good? And Susan's like, no, I need it by here. And you negotiate it out. And it's like, okay, yeah, I think I can make that work. What if I also come and cut your grass every so often and do it? Like, befriend them, right? Like, make yourself available to them as a friend to say, I'm going to make this right. Before you end up in jail, and I think it is just an illustration, right? It's a very practical one, right? But it is just an illustration that says this problem doesn't get better the longer you sit on it. It gets worse. The relationship distance grows greater and colder, and it's harder to stomach that contempt that's been sitting in the fridge overnight. Yes. It's no good. So make it quick. And if you think about it, for the times that you've hurt a friend or someone who, maybe a roommate, someone you live with, isn't it true that, like, you notice that offense and you sort of, like, you just pass it by, you're like, yeah, we'll deal with that later, or they shouldn't even be mad about that, whatever, you walk away, that it gets worse. Whereas if you can just say, hold on, I just realized I crossed a line, I just stepped on your toes, I just broke something of great value to you, and you make it right there, that you can avoid so much pain in that. I think that's the wisdom of what Jesus is getting at here about this conflict. You don't let it sit. All that points us to this really simple point, but really challenging point. Jesus calls us into a life where anger and contempt and resentment have no place. The life with God's authority and blessing is a life where these forms of anger are just flat wrong. He's like, it's not right. And I don't know if you can believe that Jesus would have the gall to say things in black and white, right and wrong terms, but he does. He gives us this permission, in a sense, to live for a higher standard. More than that, though, if you think about it, I don't know about you, but like, I don't typically have the power on my own to follow this out. He offers us the power by his word and by his spirit to live this new life of the kingdom of heaven. He's setting us free. And that's why I read the high obligations that Jesus sets out for his disciples also as promise. Because he knows you can't make it on your own. Otherwise, he wouldn't have to tell you these commands, right? He's come to show us this righteousness and to lead us into this righteousness of the kingdom of heaven. If you got business to do with God today, that's business that he wants to do with you as well. Let me see. I've lost my spot here. It's pretty clear, though. Pretty clear challenge. If you're angry, you don't clamp down. So I called this sermon, are you going to lose it or are you going to lose it? You could blow up, you could let this anger get the best of you and you could lose it, or when that anger comes up, you just lose it. Let it go. Lose it or lose it. As we sing our closing song, you might have some business to do with God today or some phone calls to make, and I would encourage you to do so and not to let it wait to hear the wisdom of Jesus in this place. Would you pray with me? God, you've spoken a big challenge to our hearts today. Would you give us the courage and the humility and the power that we don't have to walk in your freedom by your Spirit? In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Let's stand together as we sing this final song, A Mighty Fortress.
Our God is a consuming fire, a burning holy flame, with glory and freedom. Our God is the only righteous judge, ruling over us With kindness and wisdom, we will keep our eyes on you. We will keep our eyes on you. A mighty fortress is our God. A sacred refuge is your name. Your kingdom is unshakable. For his own, none can comprehend his love and his mercy. Our God is exalted on his throne, high above the heavens, forever he is worthy. We will keep our eyes on you. We will keep our eyes on you. A mighty fortress is our God. A sacred refuge is your name. Your kingdom is unshakable. With you forever we will reign. We will reign. Forever we will reign. And we will reign. Forever we will reign. Is our God. A sacred refuge is your name. Your kingdom is unshakable. With you forever we will reign. A mighty fortress is our God. Sacred refuge is your name. Your kingdom is unshakable. With you forever we will reign. With you forever we will reign. With you forever we will reign. Consuming fire, burning holy flame, with glory and freedom.
Receive this blessing. Now to him who is able to do immeasurably more than all we can ask or imagine, according to his power that is at work within us. To him be glory in the church and in Christ Jesus throughout all ages, forever and ever. Amen. Go in peace.